Welcome to Matrix Warriors. I'm your host, Jay Parker. It's November 13th, 2015, and on tonight's show, we have a two-hour interview with Ras Ben, author, lecturer, counselor. This man knows ancient history, and he knows the ley line system. Ras, how are you doing today?
Thankful. How about yourself, man?
Yeah, every day I say meditation a couple times a day, what I'm thankful for, because I'm sending out to the intelligent divine field positive energy, and it's coming right back to me.
Yes, I.
You can talk about, so I'm going to let you just introduce yourself, talk a little bit about biography, take the ball for a while, and I'll take notes and ask questions.
All right. Well, I'm Ras Ben. Right now, I've been serving in Philadelphia for about two decades. I'm originally from Washington, D.C., though. And, I just really consider myself an obedient servant to humanity. I'm a holistic wellness provider. I work with crystals and sacred stones in my works. I'm also a reflexologist, Reiki practitioner. So I kind of deal with energy, subtle healing. Usually that subtle healing is sometimes the most profound. Also, I'm just active in the community, educating youth, caring for elders, building up community, places we can, institutions and places we can come together and inform ourselves and heal ourselves. So that's kind of my work.
Well, we went to a gathering in West Philadelphia, and talk a little bit about the organization in West Philly that you're a part of, because I really had a great day there. There was music, vendors, speakers, and it was totally not the typical Black American experience.
Mm.
Talk about that organization, Ras, because it's really the foundation of the new paradigm.
Yes, I've been building with a sister named Malaika Hart, her king brother named Jawan. And they have the One Art Community Healing Center. And basically, this family reclaimed a junkyard over a decade ago. And, I was there from the early, so I actually saw it when it was just two storefronts in front of a junkyard. But over the years, they've cleaned the junkyard out and they've really built an urban oasis and sanctuary, where once you get behind these walls, you're transported through space-time to what feels like a tropical paradise. Man, they're just doing a lot of things. They're building an earthship there. They're hooked up with the folk who do the earthships. So they're building an urban earthship that can be a teaching, learning model to replicate other future earthships. They reclaimed about 10 lots that were abandoned and have set up a urban farm. The ultimate vision they got is to set up an aquaponic garden, where you got this eco loop of the growing the food to feed the fish, and the fish poop fertilizes the garden, and got protein vegetable source right here local, help the community. And so we do different events throughout the year, fundraisers to keep this thing going, but also events that are going to bless the community. So the one you came to was called the Healing Garden Party, and that's kind of a legacy, what was once called the Heal Thyself Garden Party, that some elders started a while ago. I want to say like maybe around the year 2000. Brother named Paul Bodice and a couple of other another brother by the name of Dr. Harmon. So Dr. Harmon is now an ancestor. Brother Bodice, I think, is in the Philippines or somewhere. We've kind of kept that tradition going, and it's ended up at the One Arts Center. And so, yeah, man, that's a powerful annual event where we invite holistic wellness providers from all walks. Give them a mic. Let them set up and have their products and services right there for the community. So you picked a good event to come to for your first time at Wall Street. Well, One Art.
Well, I certainly enjoyed it. And I was amazed at just the vegan food, the energy of the people there. Talk about everybody was awake and aware. I think the people that weren't, by the time they left, they were asking themselves some serious questions about their life and what they're doing on the planet. And one of the reasons that I want to have you on is your book, Rock of Ages. I want you to talk about Rock of Ages a little bit, definitely. Can you get the book on your website?
Yeah, the book is available at my website, rasben.com. And yeah, it's Rocks of Ages is really, it's not your typical A to Z encyclopedia of crystals. So like if you're looking for a book where it's like A, aventurine, B, beryl, C, chrysocolla, you might be a little disappointed. It's really designed to awaken the Earth Keeper in all of us in one of our infinite lifetimes work intimately with crystals and sacred stones. So that's in our DNA, it's in our genetics. Surveying how the ancient cultures in the Nile Valley and Mesoamerica and other parts of the world, how they worked with the crystals, sacred. It's really the intention is to awaken those chintmen, tune you into the Earth Keeper that is dormant in you. And we do provide some principles and a little science to kind of help us know our relationship to the mineral kingdom, be able to let our bodies be the book. So if you get a crystal, you don't know its name, you don't know nothing about it, all you do is you just see it. You can through awareness of yourself and your relationship with the mineral nation in general, intuit ways that you can use that stone for healing.
Well, it's amazing to me that Rocks of Ages, you just go through so many different avenues of research. One of the things I really enjoyed about the book was, of course, Dogon tribe in Africa, which has a cosmic awareness of galactic history, that to this day, Ross, the academics are still saying it's nothing but a coincidence.
Right.
That's just so ridiculous. Talk a little bit about the Dogon, if you can, for people that don't know about them.
Yes, I. Well, man, you hit it right on, because right when you say in terms of galactic history, planetary history, that's an untapped resource. And anthropologists who studied with the Dogon, Grial and Detelin, to their credit, they attempted to be as transparent as possible and not put any interpretation or cultural bias in the transmission of information that the Dogon shared. So you can find their cosmologies clearly articulated in the book The Pale Fox. Their claim to fame, how they did get some notoriety, is because they had spoke about the reality that the star system Sirius was actually a binary star system. And they had great detail on the visible star Sirius as well as its invisible dark star companion. And so they spoke of this prior to Western scientists confirming that. So then, oh, they got some notoriety, but then get a lot of, what do you say, revisionists who would want to say, oh, some Greeks gave them that information, or some ETs gave them that information. Kind of like you say, discrediting them as a valid source because they're African. But the reality is, is that when you study the pale fox, not only do they identify Sirius as a binary star system, they describe our galaxy in amazing scientific detail as far as the nature of the supermassive black star that's the core of our galaxy, what they call the Poe. They say it's the tiniest seed, meaning its gravitational force is so strong, its molecules are so compact together, even though it's the largest object in our galaxy, it's molecularly, it's as if it's the smallest. And that's why it is a singularity, a point where time, space, energy, and matter are all the same thing, all at the same time, all at the same place. Dogon clearly articulate all of that. Describe the event horizon. They describe it as like a tablet on which these ancient characters are written that spells out the destiny of all the star systems that are a part of our galaxy. They say that that dark star that is the companion to Sirius A, they call it Potolo. They say it's the first star that was born within this galaxy. First, you know, like main sequence star, which will follow because where we are, because the Sirius star system is our celestial neighbor. It's only 8 light years away, which is, you know, like a stone's throw, celestially speaking. They say that, like I said, Sirius B, which they call Potolo, they say it was the first star. So you figure you have a dark star. That means it went through its whole life as a main sequence star, like our current star is, right? And it is in the outer reaches of our galaxy, because our planetary system, as well as the Sirius system, we're kind of at the edge of the galaxy. We're closer to outer darkness, the space, the omniversal space outside our galactic community, than we're closer to the galactic core. Dogon describe all of that. They say that our sun was a part of a binary star system at one time, but that our sun is a rebel spirit that they call Ogo, and that our sun jumped out of its placenta prematurely, and that that's the reason we're not a part of a binary star system like most stars in the galaxy. And that even beyond that, the trajectory that our sun took, it took it out of the Milky Way community. So our sun should be in a binary star system within that Milky Way cloud that we see. But it strayed its course. It was an angel that rebelled, a celestial figure that didn't follow its intended trajectory, its intended path. And to correct that, Sirius A and Sirius B was manipulated by what the Dogon call Amma, who's like the awareness at the center of the galaxy. Sirius A is like that first which is, you know, the visible star Sirius. That's the sacrificial fish, that this celestial fish being that sacrificed itself to kind of atone for Earth. Okay, this is how the Dogon kind of depict Sirius A. When you study astrophysics, anytime a main sequence star is in a binary system with a dark star like Sirius B, you know its plasma is being sucked into the heavier dark star. And that's the relationship between Sirius A and Sirius B. But Sirius B, the Dogon say, reorganized the heavens. So the celestial order that we have now, where our sun travels through what appears to be those 12 gates of the zodiac, the sun and the moon are the exact same diameter, and other significant aspects of what we know as our place in the solar system and our place in the galaxy. It was anchored by the dark star of Sirius B. And Sirius B is actually our sun's central sun. Our sun is rotating, just like our planet rotates around our sun rotates around Sirius B. That's kind of like a general overview of what the Dogon say about where we are in the galaxy. But they do say that there's a day coming, a day that they call Tabatolo, which is the reuniting of the twin placentas, which ultimately Sirius B is directing our planetary system back to, remember we said our sun had a twin originally. So that might be what we're witnessing with these two suns, how there's been a lot of footage lately of a second sun that's visible a little bit before sunrise, a little bit before sunset. This might be what they call Tabatolo, the reuniting of the twin placentas. So that's a quick touch on the Dogon.
Well, the book is The Pale Fox, right?
Yes. Yes.
Certainly sounds fascinating, Ross. Well worth a read. Your book at Rocks of Ages, I found fascinating. Great history in your book. Great cosmology. I make organite, so I'm totally into stones and crystals. I use about 20 different stones in my work making organite. And all I have to say is everything is energy. And you've got to get with the energy of the mineral kingdom, because
absolutely,
it will absolutely enhance your life. It'll protect you in ways you can't even imagine. I have people who contact me on Facebook who are SRA victims and targeted individuals, and I'll send them my Organite Protector Pendant. They'll put it on. The darkness will leave them. All I have to say is, if you think it's a joke and it's hocus pocus, people that make energy devices like Organite, you need to do some research, because my mother, the Illuminati witch that she was, always made energy devices. Feathers, crystals, she used all sorts of material, organic and inorganic, to manipulate the field. And we live in a energy field of 52 waveforms, and we need to get back to our energy being consciousness.
Yes, and that is a big intention with Rocks of Ages. And to affirm what you're saying, life force energy, mental information, emotional energy, those are all emotions. I'll just say emotions. These are all subtle energies. And if you want, and there's a principle of creation that says the subtler informs the denser. So our spirit informs our mind informs our emotions, and our emotions inform our physical body. That's why they're called emotion. They put our body in motion. If you want to control some, right, most enslavement today, they're not using shackle and chain. Most enslavement and bondage today is affected through subtle energy. And if you're not in control of your energy, if you're not master of your own energy, then you have to ask who is. You do have to empower yourself with tools to help you master your energy. Why? Because there's tools being used to enslave your energy. Cell towers, the TV, the computer, the cell phone, all them things, all those devices, beyond just that they live effect, projecting thought form emanations into your mind to impel you to do their will. These things is also devitalizing, takes away your life force, which weakens your will. So yeah, we need tools to combat this thing, and that's what the crystals, sacred stones, and organite is all about.
Well, I just want to say that you're definitely a teacher of a lot of cosmology. Just looking at your book, Rocks of Ages, here, something you say in the beginning of the book, the earth is heavy. Growing up in an Illuminati family, I would say the earth is very heavy. I mean, it's dense. One of the things that amazed me, Ross, is when you really start to look at reality, and quantum physics right now is starting to teach people how to look at the nature of reality truthfully for the first time in probably since the Great Flood of 9600 BC. We're starting to realize that we matter and that every one of us contributes to this reality. Yes. And so if you want to change the paradigm, if you want to change the world, then you need to get informed, get knowledge, and start to go to war, energetic war, against these dark occult who rule this world. And I keep telling people that if you want to change the world, change yourself.
That's absolutely right. We do matter. Our thoughts are important. What we focus on definitely expands. But then you got that, they call that a 100th monkey critical point, where once we have a certain number people thinking, like like each brain is like a micro mental antenna. So our thoughts, when they radiate out, not everybody, but some people are going to pick it up. Some people we're going to be in resonance with, and our thoughts will influence them. If enough of us start focusing on things that are going to bring about change, things that are going to bring about justice, things that is going to bring about a better social fabric with proper governance, because that's the thing. We do need governance. We do need some type of structure where there's someone or something that is making sure society is just, true, and right. And not just from a relative perspective, but truly from omniversal perspective, society is right with what you might call natural or omniversal law. That's just like our body needs a pituitary gland to orchestrate the rest of the glands working in sync. So too on a societal level. But right now, it's corrupt. It's a problem when more of us are visioning omniverse governance in accord with omniversal law, natural law. Then we'll see that. So what we focus on does matter. Everyone's mind does matter. Every thought is important. And that is why it is really all of our responsibilities to be the best we can be.
Well, I just had Lennon Honor from the Free Mind Conference on the show, Ross. And talk about a man who is totally into critical thinking about every aspect of his life. When you are awake and aware on the path of consciousness, it doesn't play. And you have to really practice Buddhist mindfulness and really get a hold of your emotions, get a hold of your mentation, and really start studying who you are physiologically and psychologically. And it's work, but all I have to say, I remember being under mind control most of my life and being bored. There was nothing to do. I needed drugs and drink and partying and entertainment. And now I need books. I need research. I need growth. So One of the great things that I've gotten involved with in my life since I woke up from SRA is the Free Your Mind Conference with Mark Passio and Bob Tuscan. So let's talk a little bit about your talks at the Free Your Mind Conference and the fact that you're going to be at Free Your Mind 4.
Yes. Well, I do have to say, man, that you know, I call it the Blow Your Mind Conferences, because man, it has really, I just count it as a big blessing to have asked to be a part of those events. And I think the first one I did was in 2013. Yeah, it was in a powerful spot. We were right in Center City. Energy was high, man, like how you spoke about the energy at One Art. That was really what impressed me the most. And if I could just speak freely, a lot of times when I am, what you say, in the minority in certain events, you know, it's like mostly I avoid that term white, but like a mostly Euro-American crowd, the vibes aren't right. I don't feel welcome. I don't feel no love. I don't feel like I'm really a part of the scene. You know what I'm saying? Seems like conversations I have are forced and awkward and not genuine. So for me, man, that's what really struck out the most. Man, these are some real humans, you know, and it was reflected in the quality of reasonings and discussions that I had with different ones, and the vibe and the energy and the love that I felt, man. I was like, wow, I mean, this is the type of experience that more people need in order to transcend the programs, those divide and conquer programs of racial hatred. And right, my reasoning was called Free Your Mind and Your Mind Will Follow, where I really got, because right, you're talking about freeing the mind. And I think I mentioned this principle that the subtle informs the denser. And so one of the most effective ways they have enslaved the mind of humanity is they have cut us off from our spiritual sources, which is our ancestral connections to the land. And they've done that through occupying the mounds. Show how, you know, the ones they call the founding fathers, specifically that Green Dragon Society, that Green Dragon Order coming out of Boston, that they were what you would call a mound gritter. And if right, I'm kind of assuming the mounds are earthen pyramid structures, either step or conical, that you find throughout the Americas. And they're usually not randomly distributed. They're placed on the ley line grid of the planet. And that ley line grid of the planet is like how the human body, we have meridian, where energy for specific organs run through specific channels in the body, as above, so below. So planet Earth has meridian lines as well, or ley lines as well. And usually our ancestors, our like indigenous cultures, buried their ancestors on these meridian points of the earth. So when they would go to these mounds, they could really connect with spirit. You had the ancestral energy, you had the energy of the earth, and then also they would usually align the mounds with some celestial object as well. So you go to the mounds, you're really connecting your spirit. But you find most mounds today, they have monuments, memorials, statues, edifices that big up Rome, that big up occupation of that land and the downpression of the people connected to it. And so a big part of freeing our minds is being able to reconnect with our spirits and freeing up the mound. So that was the reasoning I had at the first Free Your Mind. Well, the first Free Your Mind I was a part of, that was in 2013.
Well, I just want to say that I'm going to post on Facebook, on my Facebook page, both your talks at Free Your Mind. Really looking forward to seeing you at Free Your Mind 4. I will never forget your tape at Free Your Mind 2. Just amazing minerals and energy devices. And I really was impressed. And I just have been gifting Oregonite since I met you. Gosh, I guess it was 2006. Might have been earlier. But you had a rock and gem shop on Main Street in Manayunk in Philadelphia. And I was with Michael Falsetta, the executive producer of Free Your Mind Conference. And I said, well, let's go and see Ras Ben and pick up some quartz and some other things to make Oregonite. And he said to me, well, I did a search online, and there's a shop in, I guess it's near Germantown, and let's go to that one first. And we went there, and it was your old shop moved to Germantown. And it was really amazing that we ran into Kate and up, because when I went to your original shop in Manayunk, when I left there, Ross, the spirit of the universe practically floored me when I walked out of the shop. Like, this is super, super important. When I learned more about the mounds and about the ley line system, I gifted Fairmount. And I went to the art museum, and I've done this several times, and I'll place Tower Busters and Dolphin Ball in the river and Tower Busters around the Fairmount Mound. And Fairmount, where the Art Museum in Philadelphia is a major nexus point of the energy grid here in Philadelphia.
Yes.
I was gifting with Michael Falsetta about 30 pieces of Oregonite one day. I swear that the demons that they've placed there because of their edifice of the Art Museum and the satanic rituals that they do in that place, they were howling, howling mad that we were putting Oregonite around. They were jumping up and down. And I know people are going to say, well, Jay, you're BS crazy. And I'm telling you, when you gift and make Oregonite, you're going to have a spiritual experience with the universe. No doubt about it. Because it's the calling card of the goddess. I just have to say that the experience of learning about Oregonite from you has changed my life. And as I said earlier, I make pendants to protect people who are targeted individuals. And they write me back saying that the energy has totally changed in their life. And
wow.
Because it connects with your etheric field and strengthens it, and I have Carillion photography to prove that this is true.
Wow.
So just talk a little bit more about Mound Builders and the talk you gave in 2013 at Free Your Mind was a complete mind blower. Information that people have no idea about, but just like we have meridian systems in us energetically, the earth has the same system. And my mother, the Illuminati witch that she was, said to me that the Illuminati is working with the energy left by the indigenous culture, and they're manipulating it, and they're manipulating us. And this is why you can't watch TV, that you need to open a book and start learning and get on the path of growth.
Yes, it's real. I mean, this thing, well, ultimately, this is like what they would call Babylon, right? Where, you know, in the Bible, you have the story of the Tower of Babel. That before the Tower of Babel, humanity spoke one tongue, and then they built, I think, who was it? Nimrod. built a tower to touch the sky, and it caused the confusion of the tongues. Yeah, that's what this science is all about. And that Babylon priesthood ended up in power in Rome, and you see it played out in what you call Roman imperialism. And you, when you study the origins of Rome, you had Romulus and Remus, right? Romulus wanted to build the city on the Palatine Mound or the Palatine Hill. Remus wanted to build it on the Capitoline Hill. They fought. Romulus killed Remus. And this is like that Osar Set story, or Osiris and Set, the wicked brother killing his twin and taking over the kingdom. Romulus killed Remus, then built Rome on top of the Capitoline Mound. At that time, Italy was digitus, who are known in Greco-Roman mythology as the Aborigines, occupied Italy, also known as the Sabines. And they were mound builders. They had mounds all over the place. Romulus leveled all but seven. He leveled the others to fill in the creeks and streams around the area to make a flat urban landscape. Left seven mounds remaining. And that's how Rome got its poetic name of Cincinnati, the city of seven hills. And so United States has several Cincinnati's, cities of seven hills, Philadelphia being one of them, San Francisco. Of course, you got the Cincinnati, Ohio. There's several Cincinnati's within the United States because the United States is a resurrection of Rome. And when you study it, all of that city of seven hills science is about occupying the mounds, taking over the indigenous spiritual basis of a region, tapping that energy for their own intention and will, and cutting off the energy to those who are connected to that land by birthright.
This is exactly what my mother talked about to me when I was being trained to be Illuminati when I was a toddler, that they're working with the energy system of the mounds and the ley lines to poison the morphogenic field and keep humanity in a state of cognitive dissonance and Stockholm syndrome. And we have to, as Matrix warriors, reclaim our divine energy, both in a personal level but also in a social level. We Yes. have to come together and say, enough of this crap. We're going back home.
Yes. And, a good way, something that I advocate, synchronized amplified thought, okay? Synchronized meaning like, okay, we're going to say every new quarter full moon, right? Sunrise. Get your wands, get your crystals, get your organite, get your power tools. Survey the area in which you live. Find a power spot. And at those times, we affirm, Babylon has fallen. We affirm Rome is done. We affirm, New Age is on us. The New Age is with us. The New Day is here. The New Day has dawned. Righteousness has prevailed. We know how to articulate the intentions that are going to bring about the reality we want. So those are the thoughts that we're amplified and sharing, synchronized. That's how you win back the grid. That's how we win back the Earth grid.
Well, there are many books out now, Ross, like Tavistock Institute for Human Relations, which is the number one Illuminati cultural steering committee in London, and Dr. John Coleman has written an excellent book detailing how Tavistock Institute for Human Relations, in his book by the same name, basically uses the media and the music and the film industry to get you to look at things that are negative. And it's very subtle, but it's disempowering, and it's Illuminati mind control. And once you become aware that the television is a mind control device, you'll shut it off and you'll keep it off, because you don't want to do that to yourself. You don't want to subject yourself to dark occult manipulation. Now, all I have to say is, when I read Tavistock Institute for Human Relations, I had a cannonball emotionally in my stomach for about 2 weeks, because it was so upsetting, the information that I received in that book, of just how complete the Babylon system is as far as steering your mentality right into the pit of hell.
Yeah, but you know, an elder had told me a while ago, the more reactionary they get, the quicker they bring about their own destruction. And you're right. Now you got CERN, there's so many HARP, they got so many wild weapons out. But to me, it shows stupefying and terrifying. But then on other levels, we could interpret it as, yeah, they ain't got much time left, because they're really pulling out all the stops. And usually when you're at that point, you're about to undo yourself. I personally don't feel like, even though I share a lot of information, I'm not at war. I'm at peace. I don't feel like I have to fight Babylon. I'm going to watch them self-destruct while I'm at peace. And I think that, and why I say that is because once we are at war, we've already lost, because that means they've changed our vibration within us. Our frequency is now at their resonance. I want omniversal love resonating inside of me. Not because I'm a pussy and I'm weak and I'm soft, but I realize omniversal love is the same force as gravity, same force as magnetism, that force which attracts and brings us together. Magnetism, love, gravity, overtones of one another. So if I want the force of gravity, which we know is the strongest force manifest in the cosmos, if I want the force of magnetism, which is probably the strongest force within the mental plane, if I want those two forces working with me, then I got to keep a love frequency. So I got to be at peace. I can't be at war. So I'm not fighting nobody. I'm just sharing truth with my brethren and my sistren. I'm being a living example of what I want to see. Sir, helping elders, helping the infant, bettering our community, helping the sick, helping the hungry, and in that way changing the collective's frequency. More love. The more love we have, then again, the more empowered we are, because we are now aligned with gravity and magnetism as a collective now. And then Bobby Wrong is done. And then, like, you opened up the show saying, I know what I put out is what I'm going to receive. It's the same with Bobby Wrong. So, right, I've heard the omniverse is a mirror and we are magnets. And that's the matrix. The omniverse is a mirror that's always going to reflect back to you whatever you're putting out. And we are magnets, that whatever is inside of us, that's what we're going to attract to us. So you're right. That's why Babylon does want to program us and impel us to do the wrong, to see that vile, defiled reality that they project with the TV and all those things. And we definitely, you're right, we are responsible for what we allow into our mind. We got to cut that stuff out, because even that does infect other people's minds. What do I mean by that? You know how sometimes a song will just pop in your head, right? it might not be that that song got in your head through radio waves coming from a broadcast antenna, but let's say someone was listening to that song and singing that song, and they drive by your house, and that song's all in their head, all in their mind. And like I said, we are influenced by how each of us think. So if you let that song get in your mind and you singing it, right, then those thought forms coming through your mind are going to impact somebody else. You know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And I was listening to Kevin Trudeau the other day. He did a presentation back in 2007 called Your Wish is Your Command. And it was $300 when Mark Passio and I got this 14-CD set back in the day. And now it's available on Amazon for $15. You can buy the entire CD set. And I would recommend anyone to buy Kevin Trudeau's Your Wish is Your Command. Now, he focuses on the law of attraction based on selfish get what you want mentation. But he stresses that feeling good, other people have expanded on this, that love is the cosmic energy of the universe. And we are in a place right now on Earth where we're waking up to the mind control of our masters, and we're realizing we've been duped, and we're going back to source. And we're in the photonic belt. We're at the edge of the galaxy, as far as the sun being on the equator of the galaxy. And in the photonic belt, a lot of energy is pouring into the planet, and energy is being given from the center of the galaxy, the Milky Way, to the Earth. And we're seeing a rise in consciousness, and this rise is being offered to us. It's not being forced. It's going to be an individual decision by the human race, whether you want to, as Paul says in the Bible, let go of the evil thing. Are you going to let go of the mind control program, the solipsistic mind control program of selfishness, and become a cell in a living human community of care and of love? And we have a choice. It's not being forced on us, and we individually have to pick up the ball and run with it. And this is what Matrix Warriors show is all about, is yes, connecting with people who are out there, who are awake and aware, like the Free Your Mind Conference people, just clarion call to humanity that we are not at war. In fact, I was meditating the other day, and from the divine field, I got this image of myself as the joyful warrior. And to be a warrior, to me, is not a violent thing. It's not a use of force. It's a method of existence. It's a being. And when you are being love, and when you are being truth, you're on the path, and every day you just don't have enough time to learn, grow, meditate, pray. You just don't have enough time to do all the positive things you want to do. But you realize, if you study quantum physics of Dr. Joe Dispenza and Dr. Bruce Lipton, Einstein talked about this, Edison talked about this, that we are the most powerful broadcaster and receiver of energy and frequency on the planet.
Yes.
The human mind is the number one battlefield for freedom.
Yes.
And it's an individual individual war. And I'm not saying my mentation is I'm not at war with the Illuminati. I was for years. I was angry about what I'd been through with the SRA, satanic ritual abuse, and all the crap I went through. I got to the point of listening to Alex Jones and some of the other mudslingers where I was like, you know, Ross, this is like gargling with sewage and expecting your breath to be minty fresh. I mean, it's ridiculous. I mean, it's the focus is wallowing in the negative. And if we want to change this world, we have to come to the realization of what my mother told me back in 1962 when she said to me, the most important thing to the Illuminati is the collective subconscious. And this is a consensus reality consciousness holodeck. And when you realize that you're here for consciousness growth, well, you don't grow in consciousness focusing on the negative. You grow in consciousness by becoming a warrior of love, by becoming an ambassador of truth.
Yes, I affirm that, bro. Yeah, so, yeah, man. And even just that, the fact that this is what is coming through ones in this time, because we hear echoes of this reasoning, like you say, from a lot of different teachers. Yeah, it's affirming for me that, yeah, even though, right, if we allow ourselves to, there's enough things on the planet that would cause us despair and dishearten us, because yeah, it's a lot of messed up things jumping off, but there's just as much as that, there's a lot of good too. And a lot of times we got to look inside to see that good. So that's I definitely affirm those things. Yeah, so I had mentioned that we definitely need to empower ourselves with certain tools to change our frequency and our vibration, and that crystals and sacred stones are some of the best tools for that. Definitely the frequency harmonizer of the mineral kingdom is the quartz family. Quartz is really, it is the crystal used in most modern technology, because beyond being able to transmit, generate energy and frequencies, quartz also can store information. That's amazing when you think about it. So quartz, we could do so many things with. The clear quartz, I think, is really great for, like we say, the free your mind work. Okay, you want to program a specific intention in a quartz. You want to use a quartz to deprogram thought forms and thought patterns that have been programmed in. Clear quartz is excellent for that, as well as the family of quartz they call the celestial quartz, which is like encoded skeletons. They also call it skeletal quartz or Jacquari quartz, but it's the quartz with encoded etchings and patterns that kind of look like a motherboard. You hold it in sunlight and move it slightly, you see a binary code expressed and how the light bounces off the etchings and patterns. So quartz is really great for that. I would also mention there's another family of stones that I think are vitally important today, and that is the copper family. Malachite, azurite, chrysocolla, turquoise. Okay? Malachite is copper oxide, azurite is copper carbonate, chrysocolla is copper silicate, and turquoise is copper sulfite, copper sulfate. So the copper stones are the stones that remove stored trauma. So all of your community that's dealing with the SRA, they got all of that stored trauma in their body because of abuse inflicted upon them, right? It's the copper stones that remove the stored trauma. So malachite is kind of it's kind of omniversal where you can use it. Any place you got the stored trauma, okay? Genital region, head area, wherever, malachite is great. Azurite is kind of good for, again, targeting the mind. It has that deep blue, that azure frequency, which tends to activate the pituitary and pineal. So that makes it good for like haunting memories, traumatic visions. You saw something that you can't get it out of your mind, or you experience something and the memory of it haunts you, or you have guilt and shame from past behaviors and actions that are preventing you from forgiving yourself. Azurite is really good for that. The chrysocolla is a throat heart connector, right? Helps us speak our truth. Okay, so if the truth has been beaten out of you, you know, you're now repressed from speaking the truth, chrysocolla help free that up. Turquoise is good for like the heart solar plexus, getting stored trauma out of that. Malachite's real good for the heart too, I should mention that. So that copper family is very important today, because you know we live in what they call that post-traumatic times. You know, everybody got some post-trauma, post-traumatic war syndrome, post-traumatic slavery syndrome, post-traumatic rape syndrome. It's everybody's walking around with stored trauma, and it's real. This, so malachite is the, I feel, an ideal tool for those. And the copper family, the copper stone family is really good for that. Iron stones, iron-based stones help us be our magi, because the magi, magicians, illusionists use electricity. Magis use magnetism to magnify and magnetize the reality they want. So if you are not magnetic, a magi who is not magnetic, you're not doing nothing, you know. So we have to magnetize ourselves. So we got to be eat iron rich foods, you know. Got to make sure we're iron rich internally. Then we can use iron based stones to really augment our magi magnetic self. And those include hematite and pyrite, siderite, garnet's got a high iron content, amethyst, the purple and amethyst, citrine, the golden citrine, that's iron, so that's quartz and iron, ferrous, silica dioxide. So those iron based stones help us really be that magi and increase our vitality. A lot of us, right, we got chemtrails dropping on us, denatured GMO food, all that crap devitalizes us, makes us weak, makes us low energy. So the iron stones are good counters for that, get us energized. I should mention protection stones, right, because we got all that craziness to defend against. Black tourmaline is a premier defense stone. I know a favor of yours, Jay, that gold fleck obsidian and the rainbow obsidian, great protection. They say the gold fleck obsidian even protects you from yourself. And sometimes that's what we need the greatest protection from, ourselves. Labradorite and the feldspar family, the carbon silicate family, which includes moonstone, numite, and labradorite. Those are great protection stones that we can work with. So those are all, just real quick, those are some good stones to familiarize yourself with. And you want to definitely keep your stones clean and charged. Put them in, go find yourself some fresh live water near where you live, place where you can safely put them in a creek or stream and not have them wash away. It's a good way to energize them. Find a well-rooted tree you could put your stones on the roots of. Let them sit out overnight, maybe on a full moon, new moon. Great way to energize, charge your stones. Organite, great way to energize and charge your stones. Get yourself a nice plate of Organite or something that you can sit your stones on. Yeah, Organite definitely is a great energizer and charger. Also got the aromatics like sage, frankincense, great ways to energize your stones. Let's say you have specific traumas and specific psychological issues you want to work through. You can get the Bach flower remedies and the FES flower essences and familiarize, you know, get that Flower Essence Society encyclopedia of flower essences where they kind of list the flower essence by psychological issue. And you can use those flower essences to program your crystals. Let that plant awareness inform the crystals and program the crystals. And that oftentimes will bring about subtle but profound healing. And we definitely need to work. I think we should think using the mineral kingdom in conjunction with the plant kingdom. Them two synergistically work well. Ganja and crystals, yeah, I feel they work hand in hand in terms of affording that quantum healing, healing on levels below the consciousness and above the consciousness. So our minds don't necessarily get in the way because of programming. And ganja and crystals are a great way to deprogram also.
Well, yeah. One of the things that I'm a big supporter of is cannabis freedom. And the more study I do into the healing power of cannabis, they've known in the government here in America since 1974 that THC and CBD, two of the components in cannabis, heals cancer 100% of the time. And the suppression of cancer cures is a huge big pharma Illuminati eugenics program. And we've lost close to 20 million Americans since 1974 due to cancer. And these people have paid for chemotherapy, which costs a fortune and kills you, when you could take cannabis oil or juice raw cannabis and get your endocannabinoid system back in line with the divine energy field and heal yourself, and it would cost nothing. I'm going to do a website on cannabis in the future. My belief is that the divine spirit put cannabis on the planet to heal us when we go astray. And right now, more and more people in social media are talking about the fact that we are using chemotherapy, which is 3% effective, when cannabis is 100% effective. Now, there are some people who take Rick Simpson oil, a concentrate medicinal oil from the indica cannabis plant, and they still die from cancer. Well, this is the nocebo effect. If you believe you're going to die, your mind is strong enough to kill you. And when you study the placebo and the nocebo, which Dr. Joe Dispenza has written a book called You Are the Placebo, it's absolutely a mental construct. Your entire social and physical and emotional makeup, it's all coming from what you're thinking. So you need to put good thoughts in and remove bad programming. And I stress to people that nothing is going to change your life like grabbing hold of your mind and really start to analyze what the ego, that which you have been given by your culture in the first 6 years of your life. It's the satanic sophistic ego system. It's the me, and the hell with everyone else and the hell with the planet. This is a unnatural, Babylon mentation that you get in the first 6 years of your life when you are in the programmable state. In the first 6 years of your life, you have two brainwave patterns and your subconscious is being built. Well, you cannot differentiate any information coming into you until you get the third brainwave pattern. And so in the first 6 years of life, your subconscious is being built and it runs 90% of your life, maybe even higher. So you need to do energy modality work on your subconscious by tapping with EFT or using Psyche or using focused meditation or swaying. There are many energy psychologies out there. Yeah. And they're very good for changing the program. And that's what we're talking about at the Free Your Mind Conference a lot. We're talking about individuals getting back to their innate power and lining up with Source.
Yes. Yeah, and the Celestial Quartz is really good in those works too. That deprogram, reprogram. And those are my favorite quartz. And those are the ones I will more time feature if I'm so blessed to have, you know, be able to come across some. Yeah.
Where do you find it?
Well, I go out to the Tucson Gem and Minerals Show every year because what I found is that where you get your stones from, who you get your stones from, it really does matter. You had forced labor, child labor, harvesting those crystals, or you just blew up a mountain to get the crystals. Yeah, man, the energy on them stones aren't going to be right. So the Tucson Gem Show allows me to deal with people that are just like myself, who harvest the crystals in a sustainable, loving way. And it matters. The energy on the stones do matter. So I've been going to that for over a decade, and I've connected with Brazilians. That's who I get most of my celestials from. Some Peruvians, you know, I've built relationships with folk who are, you know, tapped in crystals from their land, and I work with them. It's an annual event. So, like, right, when you saw me in April, I had just come back from Tucson. My table was crazy, crazy fat. You look at my table now, it's kind of bare bone because, that's really the only place I'll shop for crystals is Tucson. And that's the first 2 weeks of February every year.
Now,
next year, I heard Denver show in September. I wasn't able that September, but I am going to, creator willing, I will be in Denver this September for a couple of reasons. One, I want to check out that show, but also I do want to just see Colorado and its freed up reality now.
Well, it's nice that Colorado has medical cannabis and allows people to grow 6 marijuana plants, cannabis plants, per person. My focus on cannabis medicinally is I've done research, Ross, and if you juice raw cannabis, you get all the health benefits. When you heat cannabis, you actually destroy a lot of the medicinal nutrients in the plant.
Right.
And we need total cannabis freedom, like was in America in 1936, before the Illuminati oligarchs made cannabis and hemp illegal. There's no reason that cannabis is illegal. It's only a psychoactive drug when you heat it. So the real vegetable that is cannabis, because it produces seed that you can eat,
right.
It is a vegetable. It is a perfect homeostasis creator. It regulates all your organs, regulates all your neurons. It's good to open your pineal gland. And there's the more research that's done on cannabis, the more they're finding out that this is God's gift to the universe.
It's the healing of the nations.
Absolutely.
As my Rasta elders teach, herb is the healing of the nations that can put food, clothing, fuel, shelter, and medicine in, accessible to the multitudes, as well as have the means of production in the hands of the masses.
Well, this is why it's illegal.
Of course, that's why it's illegal. Yeah, because, yeah, man, Babylon can't. It's one thing. Babylon will have a very hard time to control if it was made free. Yeah, because if our food, clothing, fuel, shelter, and medicine, along with the means of production, is in our hands, what do we need Babylon for? We don't. So yeah, that's the vision. You know, sad to say, man. I mean, we take a critical eye at this quote-unquote war on drugs, which was a war with drugs. But a big part of it was making sure that when Herb was freed up, because they knew eventually they was going to have to free it up. It was inevitable. Yeah, that means of production was going to be out of a lot of indigenous people's hands. Like how most of the Herb now is Northern Cali, but places like Jamaica, down south, yeah, you could have year-round ganja production, male and female plant. And that is something else that, right, how we do focus a lot on the female plant. I love the feminine principle, but it has to be more balanced. We have to work with the male and the female plant, because it's the male plant that produces the hemp seed, and that's important nutrition.
Well, Ross had to leave us. He's taking care of his father, who's living with him in hospice care. Ross is a dedicated family man, has 7 children, and he's raising his children, and he's teaching them a valuable lesson about family by giving his father hospice care at the end stage of his life. So his total commitment to being a human being, to being a light worker and an energy healer and teacher, is profound. Really great talks at the Free Your Mind. We're going to talk about both his talks, 2013 and 2015, when the show continues right now. If you are a Facebook friend of mine, I will post links to both Ras Ben's talks at the Free Your Mind Conference, or you can go to freeyourmindconference.com and watch the videos there on the Free Your Mind Conference website. Ras Ben taught me about Organite, and all I have to say is, if you're not making Organite, at least you can do is get some for the EMF protection, for the spiritual protection. I make excellent Organite myself, and going out with my Free Your Mind Conference friends and gifting hundreds of pieces of Organite, hitting tower after tower, driving, one day we drove 350 miles, hitting tower after tower. We had a list from towerco.com, and we just drove around and put tower busters under every cell tower in this entire valley, and we spent the whole day. It was like a 10-hour day. 350 miles we drove, and the three of us were blessed out of our socks. And this is the work that we have to do as a new paradigm community. Not just talk, but actually do the work. So let us continue, and let's go to rossben.com and just take a look at his website, and we'll do that together. So if you want to open up another browser window and get to rossben.com and follow along with me, feel free to. It should be a good talk, and we're going to talk a little bit about the Free Your Mind Conference videos that he's already done, and the work he has on YouTube. And we're going to talk about cannabis. Yes, cannabis is the crux. It is the focal point of bringing down the oligarchs. So I'm at the Ras Ben website, rasben.com, lowercase letters, all one word. And I thought I'd read the Who is Ras Ben biography. Ras Ben is an innovative educator, counselor, wellness provider, peacekeeper / mediator, sacred timekeeper, and scribe. Originally from Washington, D.C., Ras Ben has served in the Philadelphia area for over a decade, falling in love with the city after receiving an M.A. from Temple University in African American Studies in 1992. Ras Ben is a self-published author and has recently released Rocks of Ages, a new edition. Rocks of Ages is a culturally centered survey of the therapeutic use of crystals and sacred stones and explores the importance of utilizing them in these prophetic times. A family man who advocates healthy home environments for the youth, Ras Ben has been married for 22 years and is the father of 7 children. Ras is a spirited man who brings divine presence to all the events he is. Ras Ben at Peace Weavers Gathering in 2003, sharing a prayer, a sparrow landed upon his head. And this is the famous Ras Ben picture of the bird on his head, which is pretty funny. And it's also a sign from the divine universe that he's a friend of nature. And he's one with the energy field that is the universe, that is the truth. The universe is love and is compassion. And once you get on the center path in life, and you realize that you're here to live and grow in consciousness, not to be unconscious, not to be a zombie staring at your cell phone, being entertained to death. Roger Waters of the Pink Floyd just did a musical number called Entertained to Death. And if there's one thing that really sums up the American civilization right now, it's the fact that people are being entertained to death while they eat GMO food, while they drink the fluoride, while they breathe the chemtrail air. They're being entertained. Well, put away the entertainment and get some real entertainment. Get Rocks of Ages, a new edition from Ras Ben. This book, Rocks of Ages, as so much information in it, it's not even funny. But one of the things I really like about Rocks of Ages is galactic history, something that you'd have to grow up in the Illuminati to realize that this isn't the only age that mankind has been in. Ross knows this, and so do I, and my parents openly talked about Atlantis. My father called himself an Atlantean warlock. Well, we're talking pre-Diluvian times, so that means 9600 BC when the quote-unquote Noah's Flood happened. You know, we're talking 12,000 years ago. There was a high civilization in this country, in this world, that the indigenous people from Lemuria actually built. That's why you see pyramids all over the world. Those pyramids, when you really look at the Egyptian pyramid, I mean, it could go back as far as 25,000 years. There is a watermark on the side of the Great Pyramid of Cheops, 3/4 of the way up. There's a watermark, which means it was standing during the Great Flood. That Great Flood is written about in 3 books by the authors Allen and Dallaire. Allen and Dallaire did 3 books on that great catastrophe. that happened at 9600 BC. I recommend that you read at least one of them to get an idea of the state of shock to see it, the entire world destroyed. A supernova fragment, according to Allen and Dallaire, moved between the Earth and the Moon. It also caused great damage to other celestial bodies in our solar system, particularly Mars. But what's amazing about this event was the gravitational field from this high-speed supernova fragment traveling between the Earth and the Moon. It pulled all the water of the planet up to the northern hemisphere, almost like seeing the top of a soft ice cream cone. And then, as the gravitation got weaker and weaker, as the supernova fragment moved away from the Earth and Moon, it released the water. That's why indigenous cultures, like in America particularly, say that there was a wall of water 150 feet high that traveled from east to west across the United States. And there's also sinkholes in Oregon, which are from this flooding. We're talking about a 150-foot tall wall of water moving, because it was under the power of gravity, very slowly, to where the animals were actually running in front of the wall of water. Few people understand that a cataclysm like that, that ends a high civilization, produces a state of shock in the people who survive. That's when the dark occult in this world decided, well, since everybody's in a state of shock, we'll just take over, and we'll feed them BS, and we'll keep them in the dark, and they'll be our slaves. In fact, we'll nickname the people the Mushroom People, because they're kept in the dark, and they're fed BS. That's a little joke that I have. But looking at that cataclysm, and looking at the world and the control system that we have today, if you really want to look at how this happened, get one of the books by Allen and Dallaire on the cataclysm of 9600 BC. And the best book, the one I read, of course, there's three books that Allen and Dallaire did, but the best book, Cataclysm 9600 BC, talks about the 200-mile-an-hour winds, talks about the geological damage from the flood, and it's a complete mind-blower. And when you look at the devastation, like in North America alone, 52 genera of animals were disappeared. Saber-toothed tiger, the mastodons, you get the picture. So those that survived were in a state of shock. Easy prey for the dark occult to move in and claim to the ignorant masses, this is what happens when you don't obey me. But one of the great things about Rocks of Ages is the first section is based on astrotheology, the great year, Kemetic Star Clock, the Mayan Mystery, about Sirius, the Olmec Mayan Cosmology. It's really good stuff. And few people understand galactic history. There's a man by the name of Dan Winter on YouTube, and whether you believe everything Dan Winter says about galactic history and the reptilians and everything else that's out there, you have to open your mind a little bit that something is going on, and the human race is not the only peoples that are sentient in the universe. I mean, our planet is 4.5 billion years old, yet the universe is 12 billion years old, plus. So that means if it takes naturally 4.5 billion years to produce a sentient species that's capable of technology and communication, that means the Earth is literally 8 billion plus behind those that came before. And just think about technology, ladies and gentlemen. If you've got 1,000 years of technological advance on a species, why, you can run them right into the ground. And that's probably the story of the Anunnaki, because as I grew up in the Illuminati, I was told that Earth was invaded and that the Anunnaki took over. The thing is, it's a spiritual invasion. It's a mind parasite. And we can change this whole paradigm. Because as the indigenous people on this planet, we are in control. It's just that we've been told that we're disempowered. We've told that we're mindless. It's a bunch of crap, and we're taking back our planet from all these interdimensional, extraterrestrial, and blah, 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 non-human, non-loving sources. Now, Ras Ben has 2 books out, and I totally recommend Rocks of Ages. It's a great book, and you're just going to expand your mind. There's lots of stuff on stones, especially quartz. There's lots of articles about Africa, Lemurian sea crystals, all kinds of spiritual and esoteric information. And the man's done his homework. And no bookshelf is complete without it, as far as I'm concerned. And being someone who appreciates the Mineral Kingdom, I definitely, definitely recommend the book. And just looking at his, you know, website, the book presentation is, you know, talks about the Olmecs, the crystals, spiritual attunement, history, mystery, and prophecy of the Rastafari. And believe me, you know, what's funny about the Rastas is they get a really bad rap in this country. You know, just a bunch of potheads. But the truth of it is, these are people that center their consciousness in the ancient ways of Kemet, which is a word for Egypt. And they're not playing games. And they raise their family. And they take care of their children and their parents. And they're examples of humanity that everyone needs to take a look at. Because we live in a society where the family has been destroyed culturally by the New World Order. And we need to look at how people who have held together generation after generation, the ancient wisdom, live, and what they honor. Energy flows where attention goes. What are you putting your attention to? Ras Ben puts his attention to the ancient healing wisdom of Africa. And I just want to say, that's a good place to start. The cradle of civilization. So Ras Ben did a talk at the Free Your Mind Conference in Philadelphia, called Free Your Mind and Your Ass Will Follow. It's kind of funny. But the whole talk was a mind blower about the energy field, about the ley lines in Philadelphia, about the mound building and the mound destruction by the Illuminati patriarchs who founded America. My mother told me that Benjamin Franklin was Illuminati. My mother also told me that William Penn was a warlock and Illuminati. And Ras Ben gives a talk at Free Your Mind 2008, 2012, I mean 13, that just 1 hour of information you're not going to get from anywhere else. The ley line system in Philadelphia is very powerful, but according to some scholars of the ley line system, it's a temporary power, and it's going to fade away. In fact, we're in that fading stage right now. The reason that the Illuminati chose Philadelphia was because it's on the Arcadian ley line. The Arcadian ley line stretches all across the world, but you will find it goes through London, it goes through Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Washington, D.C., Stone Mountain, Georgia, and Mobile, Alabama. And the reason that they love the ley line system in the Illuminati is they can pour their satanic energy from rituals into the ley lines because they know the spots where the vortexes are. They have also degraded the natural mounds and put their edifices on top and changed the positive energy of the goddess into a negative energy. And we have to, as a people, rise up individually and collectively and start to use the tools that nature gives us and the tools that the universe has given us, our spirit, our minds. The human being broadcasts a energy from their heart mind that goes around the entire world. This has been scientifically proven by Einstein and Thomas Edison. Nikola Tesla talked about it too. What we are involved with here is a collective consensus holodeck. And what we need to do is get out of the mentation that culture has given us and go back to the things that serve us. Family, honor, love, things that come from the universal source, learning natural law, learning that the law of God, quote-unquote, of justice, that is true justice, not just us, needs to be brought back into this world. And I recommend to anybody to listen to the Ras Ben Free Your Mind 2013 presentation on the Mound Gritters, because you'll get information on the founding of America and the energy grid that you won't find anywhere else. And it's an excellent presentation, and Ross has got insight and humor in everything he does because he walks in the light. And so when you walk in the light, you can talk about the dark stuff, but you got so much better things to talk about as far as positive things you can do today to improve your lot in life and to help raise the consciousness of the planet, that you mention the bad stuff as a warning, but you don't live there. And I used to live there in the negativity of the New World Order. And I keep an eye on it. I talk about it to friends. But more and more, I realize that it's the man in the mirror that's going to make a difference on this planet. It's what I think, what I feel, and what I do to manifest the new paradigm we all want. And we can do this together by listening to Free Your Mind teachers like Ras Ben, like Mark Passio. Okay, you can change your mentation. And listening to people that have dedicated their life to service of humanity opens up your mind to a totally different viewpoint, a different worldview. The worldview that's coming out of mass media and culture is a sophistic worldview. Satanism is sophistic. It is pure selfishness to the point where you can murder somebody just for your own entertainment. I grew up in such a culture. I saw it for myself, the axe murders, the rape and torture of children. this heavy, heavy vibration of 12 to 15% of the society being brainwashed into being dark occultists, it's poisoning the morphogenic field and keeping the whole human race down. But as we see recently with Russia moving in Syria against the Rothschild American Empire, the days of Pax Americana, we can bomb for peace anywhere in the world, is coming to an end. The Chinese, the Russians, the Indians, the Brazilians, and God knows how many other countries are so sick and tired of America and its warmongering. There's about, I guess, 2 months left to the petrodollar. With all the saber-rattling America wants to do to start World War III, it's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. The Europeans are fed up with America. The entire world is fed up with America. We've been using our huge military to force nations to use the United States dollar as the reserve currency. In 2 months, the BRICS nations, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, will have their own International Bank of Settlements, January 2016. Every nation that has stood up against the Rothschild central banking system in recent history has been invaded and conquered by America. All you have to do is look at recent history. Saddam Hussein tried to pull away from the American dollar and sell his oil in euros. He was immediately invaded. And when he asked the American ambassador, would they mind if he took the province of Kuwait back and made it part of Iraq again, once again, the American ambassador told him straight to his face, we have no treaty with Kuwait. Go ahead and do what you want to do. We don't care. So he got set up. But the fact is, he was selling his oil in euros, and he had to go. So, for 5,000 years, Iraq was part of, Kuwait was part of Iraq and part of the Baghdad culture. And then, in the 1920s, right after World War I, the British formed the Principality of Kuwait and took it away from the Iraqis. It's still part of Iraq, as far as I'm concerned. When you have a 5,000-year indigenous history, that's who you are. But the Americans, not knowing their history, had no idea what was really going on. They just trust the mainstream media. The difference between America and the Soviet Union is real simple, and I'll sum it up in this statement. In the Soviet Union, when they looked at Pravda and the newspapers and what was on TV, they knew they were being lied to. They knew it was nothing but propaganda and mind control. In America, the people actually believed the news. But that's coming to an end. A recent bit on CNN, I heard, said that 70% of the American people believe that the U.S. government is corrupt. And by corrupt, I mean has sold them out, has thrown them under the bus. The multinational corporations want to make slaves and serfs out of the entire world. But the BRICS nations of Russia, China, etc., are standing up against the Rothschild Empire, and America, in its warmongering, is on the wrong side of history. And we will find out in 2 months when the International Bank of Settlements for the BRICS of Nations gets built. They've been working on this project for several years. In January, it goes into operation. And not only will the BRICS nations be able to trade and clear their bank accounts without the Rothschilds in Basel, Switzerland, this will cause the American dollar to collapse. And when the American dollar collapses, we're talking about roughly a 50% reduction in the standard of living in the space of 2 weeks. So, as I tell people on both my radio shows, Matrix Warriors and The Center Path, The Center Path is more I try to deal a little bit more with consciousness issues, and Matrix Warriors is more about, people, I believe, that are making a difference in the world. People who are true spiritual warriors and have thrown all that they have in to consciousness and into the new paradigm. The new paradigm's coming, whether they like it or not, in the Illuminati. They know this. That's why you heard rumor after rumor. Isn't it interesting? All summer long, of a great false flag, of a great economic collapse coming in September or October. Well, it's November 13th, and we haven't had the collapse. You know why? Because the bankers know, after taking $7 trillion in cash in 2007-2008 from the American taxpayer, and getting 17 extra trillion dollars worth of loan guarantees from the federal government, that they can't collapse the economy with their musical chair economy and rip everybody off again. Because with the internet and with all the DVDs that the Ron Paul people put out for two campaigns worth, millions of them, the banking industry was exposed after 2008 for the fraud that it is. The Rothschilds are running scared now. Now, they may very well try to start a war in the Middle East, but I know one thing. The American people said no to going into Syria, and the government had to invent ISIS as a proxy fighter. But look at Saddam Hussein. He tried to sell his oil in euros, was invaded. Look at Muammar Gaddafi of Libya. The most progressive country in Africa, the richest country in Africa, the standard of living for the average Libyan was the highest in Africa. Free health care, free education. The society was ruled, quote-unquote, by a dictator, but don't we have dictatorship here? Don't the corporations tell us who we're going to vote for and who we're going to elect? As Franklin Roosevelt said, presidents are selected, not elected. And someday I'm going to do a show where I just take quotes from famous people that are mind-blowing. And that's one of them right there. Another one that comes to mind right off the top of my head is Woodrow Wilson talking about the Federal Reserve being enacted, saying, I have unknowingly ruined my country and placed it in the hands of a very small group of people. You know, it's amazing that the men in power throughout history, some good, some bad, you get their quotes together, you get a history lesson, but you got to do the research. So, the 2013 talk on the mound gridders and the ley line system, it's one of the best talks at the Free Mind Conference I've ever heard. And the reason I brought up Libya was, of course, Muammar Gaddafi was trying to produce a pan-Arab African gold denier. And he was pushing that the Africans and the Arabs needed to form their own currency outside of the American Rothschild Anglo-Saxon Illuminati Empire. And that's why he got invaded. He didn't get invaded for freedom. He got invaded because the Rothschilds knew he was serious. And he was making huge conferences with African leaders were getting together and Arab leaders were getting together, and they were moving just like the BRICS nations are moving against the U.S. dollar and against the Rothschilds. And so he got invaded. Just like we spent, admittedly, the State Department spent $5 billion overthrowing the government in Russia, the country was the Ukraine, its own independent country, but it was a province in Russia for the longest time, and it's over half the people there are Russian-speaking. But the Ukraine, $5 billion of American tax money was spent. They hired a bunch of neo-fascists, and you can go on YouTube and take a look at their flag. It's a stylized Nazi flag. These are Rothschild Zionist fascists. And the more history you study about the Zionists and the Rothschilds, the sicker it gets. And enough of negativity and history and all that stuff. But Ras Ben did another great talk at Free Your Mind 2015, the Free Your Mind 3, and he's going to be at Free Your Mind 4. And I will have them posted on my Facebook, and you can go to the Free Your Mind Conference website or the Free Your Mind Conference YouTube channel and check out his excellent talks. When this man does a presentation, and on his website, from Boston, New York, Washington, D.C., he'll travel and do all-day healing and speaking engagements. So keep an eye out on Ras Ben's website for the engagements that he has planned in the future. And he doesn't really charge that much to get in. I think the highest price I ever saw for one of his events was like $20, and it was an all-day event. So a lot cheaper than going to see a movie. So I'm going to finish out the show talking about something near and dear to my heart, which I believe will bring down this corrupt system, and that's marijuana. Now, I just called it marijuana because I'm looking at this website called medicaljane.com, and this is a great, great starting website to get cannabis information. It's well done. It breaks it up into all sorts of different areas of study. And let's just go to this one area. It's called Cannabis Classroom. More states are passing laws to allow people to use medical marijuana. So what symptoms or ailments does cannabis treat? And who may want to consider using it as a wellness product? Although pain is the main reason people seek medical marijuana, people suffering from a variety of health-related conditions may find significant release from the cannabis plant. And why is that? It's because we have an endocannabinol system that regulates every major function in our body, from our hormones, our organs, our neurons, they're all attached to our endocannabinol system. And guess what cannabis has? Cannabinols. It fits like a hand in a glove. And this is why in 1937, the Illuminati oligarchs, the DuPonts, William Randolph Hearst, and Mellon, the banker, got together and they saw the cannabis industry as a threat, and they saw the cannabis medical establishment as a threat to the medical pharmaceutical mafia that they were trying to build. Cannabis was used in recommended for over 100 different ailments in the pharmacopoeia back in 1936. So the research back then, they knew of the healing properties of cannabis. Ask yourself this. Have you ever seen a newspaper article from the 1800s and the early 1900s up till 1936 that talked about cannabis as being something evil or something to be banned or something dangerous. No, the only reason cannabis got a bum rap was the oligarchs didn't want the business competition, and that the medical mafia that the Rockefellers were building by taking over the medical colleges with their money and then saying, well, since we've given you all this money, how about we put a couple board of directors on your medical school? How about we start giving you textbooks that our pharmacological doctors have written? And slowly but surely, naturopath medicine gave way to allopathic medicine, medicine through surgery, drugs, radiation, all kinds of craziness. And we are living in the flotsam and jetsam of the Illuminati oligarch takeover of our society. Cannabis is the one drug that is forbidden to all satanic ritual abuse victims. You're not allowed to have a mind control subject under your power in the occult ingest cannabis. And why is that? It forms new neural pathways in the brain and deletes the hardened trauma-based mind control. This is one of the biggest reasons psychologically why the governments do not allow marijuana to be freely used by the people. It would break up their trauma-based mind control that comes over the mass media. I mean, look at the mass media. It's nothing but, look out, here's the boogeyman, look out, here's the boogeyman, look out, fear, 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 fear. It's nothing but mind control. Energy goes where attention goes. So they get you to look at something, that's where your energy's going. Turn away from it. Keep an eye out on what these jackasses are doing, but spend the vast majority of your time growing and learning consciousness, because you'll be 10 times happier. So I recommend my website, thecenterpath.weebly.com. You'll see some great, great videos, and I've put together some pages like 27 hours of consciousness raising videos. And if you can spend 2 hours a night watching those videos, I guarantee in 2 weeks' time your entire consciousness will change. In those 27 hours of videos, it will bring to mind things that you never knew about, things like EFT. When you start reprogramming your subconscious, like I had to do to get out of the deep subconscious mind control I was placed under, and you find that you can change habits, that you can change ideas and beliefs in your mind just by tapping on meridian points in your body, why would you suffer with depression? Why would you suffer with low self-esteem when you can use an energy healing modality like EFT or Psyche or swaying or tap and breathe and just throw the trash out of your subconscious? Clean yourself up, you know, and enjoy your life. You're here to enjoy your life, and nothing is more enjoyable than learning. And this is what this culture has taken away from the vast majority of people. They've crushed through their schooling system the curiosity you had as a child to learn and grow. Well, at the Free Your Mind Conference, and people like Ras Ben and people like Lennon Honor, they're standing up and saying, look at me, I got a handle on my life. Follow me to the promised land. And that's what we're doing at Free Your Mind Conference. I mean, you may not agree with every speaker, but I guarantee if you go to the Free Your Mind Conference, which is in April in Philadelphia, 2016, you will be a different person after that weekend. I went there in 2015 and gave a talk on Arden and some other subjects, but it was amazing being around 600 awake and aware people. The energy level, as Ras Ben talked about in the interview tonight, the energy of being around hundreds of awake and aware people is staggering for your consciousness. That's why I am screaming from the rooftops to people to change their subconscious programming. Why? Because we, every second, send into the field from our subconscious mind 40 million bits of information. And those 40 million bits of information come from the first 6 years of your life. It's all the beliefs. It's all the belief in authority. It's all the lies you were taught as a little kid. Why? I bet even the Santa Claus program is in there. And 40 million bits of information times 7 billion people will give you the collective consciousness reality that we're experiencing together. But there's a huge consciousness shift going on. And cannabis freedom is going to be a big thing in my life. I am going to do a cannabis website. And unlike the people at normal, I mean, are they people? I don't think so. I mean, how in God's name can you take millions of dollars in over the years and still not have people understand that medical cannabis is the greatest healing tool in the world, period. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. Raw cannabis juice should be ingested by people every day. Do you know that by drinking raw cannabis juice, you cannot be obese? That's right, it regulates your hormones and regulates your body function to get rid of all excess fat. Naturally, without exercise, without diet pills, without the billion-dollar diet industry. And that's why they call it diet, because it's going to die. So, let us all take a moment out of our busy lives and become cannabis aware. Let us not allow anyone in our family, anyone in our close associates, to die from cancer this year. There are enough states where you can travel with a cancer document from your doctor and get medical cannabis oil and heal any cancer. There is absolutely no reason whatsoever anyone should die of cancer in the United States of America today. You say, well, I don't have the money to send my wife to Oregon to get cannabis oil, Jay. Well, I tell you what, you make an appeal, Indiegogo appeal. You call some people who are cannabis activists in Oregon, like I have. I've talked to these people. They're willing to work with people. They're willing to help you find a place to stay for cheap. They're willing to save your life. See, it's a real difference between people who are involved in the cannabis field and people who are involved in the pharmaceutical corporations. One wants to heal, the other.